Paul's theology risks combining two characteristics of conspiratorial thinking. The Handbook of Conspiracy Theory states that besides prevailing suspicion, nefarious intent is a second crucial element in conspiracy thought. Those who conspire never have benign motives. Paul combines these two ingredients in a dangerous concoction. The sages of the day were not just misguided, but also malevolent, nefarious, in their conspiracy to crucify Jesus of Nazareth. No wonder elite resentment is a common feature of evangelicalism, a movement now in many ways entangled with QAnon. The belief that power and authority can be wrong and malicious is at the very heart of Christian belief, the crucifixion. Of course, people are conspiring and abhorrently abusing power, a point reinforced by the church's own moral crimes. But at the heart of Christian belief are ideas about the folly of the wise, the malicious use of power, and the conspiracy of the elites. It is not surprising to find Christians embracing deep state ideas and other forms of conspiratorial thinking. The apocalypse. Demonology and apocalyptic speculation can also tip believers towards conspiracy theories. On April 8, 2020, the anonymous Q posted several typically cryptic messages to his subscribers. He accused Democrats of deliberately fostering mass hysteria about the coronavirus for political ends. What is the main benefit of keeping the public in mass hysteria over COVID-19? Consider voting. Are you already awake? Q. And then, in particular, the post ended with these biblical verses from Ephesians 6. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in the strength of his power. Put on the full armor of God so that you can stand up against the devil's ploys. These are classic spiritual warfare passages concerning the Christian belief that our struggle in life is not against flesh and blood, but against rulers, against authorities, against the powers of this dark world and against the spiritual forces of evil in the celestial kingdoms, Ephesians 6:12. The demonologies that often spring from these biblical themes can be conspiratorial and violent. This is observable, argues David Frankfurter. In the literary records of many early Christian monks and in the activities of many late medieval and early modern brethren in Western Europe, who actively weaved local traditions of malicious witchcraft with demonology and official Christian heresiography with the aim of branching out the popular notion of the witch. The mixture of Christian theology and pop demonology generated violent purges, fueled by personal beliefs about the discernment and immediacy of the satanic conspiracy. The same is happening today. Frankfurter notes its emergence in modern sub-Saharan Africa, with traditional demonological interests and exorcist claims of Pentecostalism. He adds that one need only look at the eagerness with which Pentecostal Christian pastors in Nigeria and Angola conducted the identification of child sorcerers or how Catholic priests and nuns contributed to the extermination of Rwandan Tutsis. In 1994 to see the reality and dangers of pop demonology shaping Christian theology. Indeed, the QAnon movement is a particular manifestation of this same phenomenon, a kind of post-Christian political pop demonology, which has also led to violence. Frankfurter's observation of these recurring phenomena led him to ask, to what degree could Christianity itself, as a trans-regional ideology, be particularly responsible for religious violence? He concludes, Christianity has brought a unique attention and articulation to the definition of evil in societies. Its explicit attention to the absolute evil of the satanic host preoccupies its early scriptures and permeates its historical negotiations with non-Christian cultures. Social purity and earthly, utopia, apocalyptic cleansing, fighting with Satan in multiple arenas, these fundamental ideals of Christian scripture, practice, and community have provided a latent ideological predisposition to a myth of evil of varying scale. Frankfurter is particularly interested in religious violence. But the idea that certain Christian beliefs produce a latent ideological predisposition to believe in the myth is relevant to my argument. And his analysis points to a trend, certain demonologies that go wrong can make someone vulnerable to believe in a myth of evil and its corresponding conspiracy theories. These demonologies are often intertwined with beliefs about an apocalyptic end of times. For a recent article in The Atlantic, Adrian LaFrance spoke with Arthur Jones, director of the documentary Feels Good Man. QAnon reminds him of his childhood in an evangelical Christian family in the Ozarks. He said that many people he knew then, and many people he now meets in the most godly parts of the country, are deeply interested in the Book of Revelation, and trying to unpack all of its prophecies quite difficult to decipher. Jones continued, I think the same kind of person would suddenly start pulling on Q's threads and start to feel like everything is starting to fall into place and make sense. This is a deep link to be established between conspiracy thought and millennial interpretations of the Book of Revelation. The term millennialist refers to a complex amalgamation of ideas about a final salvation and the Day of Judgment. These are central themes of Christian theology, but millennialism places particular emphasis on the belief that the coming end times are both earthly, it is being played out on earth now, it is time to act, can't you see? An imminent, trust me, it's just around the corner. There is, I believe, a demonstrable link between millennial theology and conspiracy thought. Catastrophic thinking among millennial groups is also often reinforced by their frequent adherence to various conspiracy theories. So it's no surprise to find millennial language among QAnon devotees like Shelley. There are followers of QAnon who suggest that what we are going through now, in this crazy political realm that we are in now, with all the things going on in the world, is very biblical, and that it is about Armageddon. Epistemic treasures. Is Christianity then just a problem? Is Christian belief useless in an age of conspiracy and disinformation? To answer these questions in the affirmative is too hasty. For there are more than skeletons in the Christian tradition, there are precious epistemic treasures. Indeed, Christian belief can act as an effective buffer against the harmful spread of conspiracy theories. It thus plays both the role of vaccine and antidote, it can both preempt believers in a preventive manner, vaccinating them against harmful conspiracy theories, and he can debunk plots once they gain ground among Christian believers. Believe. The most dangerous lies are often those that are mostly true, see Genesis 3, 1-4.